Okay. Doing the big picture, the overview. This is the Kings part two. Now, as we saw last week, this slide will only be up there a second. The United Kingdom of Israel, that nation that Saul and David and Solomon served as kings, it split into two nations after the death of Solomon in 931 BC, as some would put it, at 930 BC. And the northern nation is known generally as Israel. The southern nation is known generally as Judah. And each of these kingdoms had a number of kings that followed one after the other. And all the kings of Judah, as I mentioned last week, with the exception of Athaliah, Queen Athaliah, who was a usurper, but all the kings of Judah, with the exception of Athaliah, were descendants of David, whereas the kings of Israel came from a number of different families. You had a number of different dynasties there. Some of the kings of Judah were righteous, but all of the kings of the northern kingdom of Israel were unfaithful to God, some more than others. So that's just some general information on the two kingdoms. Now, the northern kingdom, it continued to exist until it was vanquished by the Assyrians, the final blow coming with the capture of Samaria in 722 or 721. And the southern kingdom of Judah was captured, vanquished by the Babylonians, and the final blow came there with the fall of Jerusalem in 587 or 586, but we'll say more about that later on. Now, what I want to do, I'm trying to say something about the different kings, but you see there are a lot of kings. So I'm trying to go through, say something about them as much as I'm able. Now, next week, the schedule calls for teaching on the prophets. That's 45 minutes on the prophets. Okay, I don't know what I'm going to do about that at this point, because I can't even start and, you know, I can't even spell all the prophets in 45 minutes. So I got to think of something that I can say to you that I will think will be of some use to you. So, but I'm not sure how I'm going to handle that. But the following week, July 20th, Tony Johnson is going to teach in here, and he's going to do the fall of Samaria. And then the following week on July 27th, Lord willing, I will then teach on the fall of Jerusalem, and I'm hoping at that time I can go back up and catch some of the kings that I'm not going to be able to get to. Okay, that's all introduction stuff. Now, pick back up here. Jehoshaphat, when I was talking, Jehoram, the king of Judah, if we can situate him, in 841. Okay, 848 to 841. All right, so Jehoshaphat's son, Jehoram, he was king. He became king in 848, and I'm looking there over there. And his wife was Athaliah. Now, Athaliah is the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel. Okay, so he marries Athaliah, and when he became king, he slaughters his six brothers to eliminate them as competition. You see, this was a rough world. I say politics, rough business. This person becomes king, and he sees these brothers down here, and they're potential threats to the kingdom. And so he slaughters his six brothers to eliminate them as competition. Now, he was, as you can imagine, was a bad king, one who walked in the ways of the kings of Israel. And when you hear that about a king of Judah, that's not a compliment. When they say they walked in the ways of the kings of Israel, all the kings of Israel were unfaithful. So this is what you have here with this particular king. He's a bad king, but because of the covenant that God had made with David, he was unwilling to destroy David's house, in other words, to end his dynasty. As you see that he ended the dynasties of a number of the kings of Israel. You had a different family move in, and then you have kings, and then a different family, kings. The throne has been given to David's family permanently in Judah. So even though we have these bad kings, God doesn't completely destroy David's house. Now, Edom and the city of Libna during Jehoram's reign, they revolted against him. And Jehoram receives a letter from the prophet Elijah. Now, this letter may have come to the king. Elijah may have already been taken up when he gets this letter. So he wrote it in advance. But he winds up getting this letter. It's delivered to him, and it tells him of coming hardship on him because of his unfaithfulness. So he gets this written prophecy, this letter from Elijah, that because of his unfaithfulness, there's going to be a hardship he's going to face. and that was fulfilled in his reign. It was fulfilled when the Philistines and the Arabians invaded Judah. They took his possessions, they took his wives, and they killed all but his youngest son. His youngest son's name, Ahaziah, who's also known as Jehoahaz. Now, that's just the way it is. You have these different names. Sometimes they're different spellings, sometimes they're different names, but it's the same person. So it kills all but his youngest son, and it's also fulfilled when Jehoram dies in 841 of a gruesome intestinal disease. So he gets this prophecy, says, things are going to be bad for you because of what you've done, and you see that plays out. Now his son Ahaziah, the surviving son, under the counseling of his mother, now his mother's Athaliah, the daughter of the wicked Ahab and Jezebel. So under the counseling of his mother, this is the king of Judah now, under the counseling of his mother Athaliah, Ahaziah, who's now the king, he walks in the ways of the kings of Israel, meaning he was a bad king. He followed in their footsteps. Athaliah and her people in Israel, because that's where her family's from. So she and her peeps in Israel, they persuade Ahaziah to join with Joram, the king of Israel, in attempting to recover Ramoth-Gilead from the Syrians, just like Joram's father Ahab had attempted. I don't know if you remember that. But the same thing's going to play out. So Athaliah gets Ahaziah, the king of Judah, to go ahead and to get into an alliance with Joram and to help him in the attack on Ramoth-Gilead, and as his father had done. And Joram, who's Ahaziah's uncle, right? Because Athaliah is Ahab and Jezebel's daughter. Joram is her brother on the throne. And so it's the reigning kings of Judah. It's his uncle. Well, his uncle's wounded in this battle when he's trying to take Ramoth-Gilead back from the Syrians. And when he's recuperating or convalescing in Jezreel, the king of Israel, who's been wounded when he went to take Ramoth-Gilead, he's convalescing in Jezreel over the injuries he received there for them. Well, Ahaziah goes and visits his uncle. So we have the king of Judah goes and visits the king of Israel, who's his uncle. He's been wounded. He's recovering. He goes and visits him in Jezreel. Now, in the meantime, the prophet Elisha had anointed Jehu, a commander of the army in Israel. He had anointed Jehu to be king over Israel. So he comes and anoints him and says, "You're going to be king," and he takes off after that. But he anoints him to be king over Israel, and in keeping with Elijah's, it's Elisha who anoints Jehu to be king over Israel, but in keeping with Elijah's earlier prophecy against Ahab in 1 Kings 21, he ordered him to kill Jezebel and to kill the descendants of Ahab, as had been done to the house of Jeroboam and the house of Baasha, where he's going to end his dynasty. He's going to take he's not only just going to end his dynasty, he's going to stop his line as punishment for his wickedness. So we have him, we have that Elisha goes and he anoints him king, and in keeping with that prophecy, orders him to kill Jezebel and to kill the descendants of Ahab. Well, Jehu then, he goes to Jezreel and he kills the fleeing Joram. They meet and Joram tries to take off. This is the king of Israel, and he kills him. He kills him, and then Ahaziah... Well, first he throws Joram's body in Naboth's field. You see how proper and fitting that is. Kills him and throws him in Naboth's field. You remember that Ahab had taken Naboth's vineyard. His wife Jezebel had him killed. So he kills him and throws him in the field, but he also kills the king of Judah, who had been visiting Joram in Jezreel when he's recuperating. He kills Ahaziah, the king of Judah, and you got to put a number of things together, but the way it looks like Ahaziah managed to escape and to flee to Samaria, but he's soon captured and brought to Jehu, near Ibleam, 10 miles south of Jezreel. He escapes. This isn't spelled out, but it looks like when you put things together, he escapes, and this time he's mortally wounded and he dies in Megiddo. So this is the king of Judah now, Ahaziah. Jehu kills them both. He dies in Megiddo and he's brought back to Jerusalem. Ahaziah's downfall was ordained by God. You see that in 2 Chronicles 22:7. Well, at some point during those events, Jehu, he goes to Jezebel in Jezreel. And this is a story where he goes there and she's mocking him, you know, giving him lip, basically. And he comes there and she's upstairs and he says, "Hey, anybody with me?" And the eunuchs toss her right out the window. Toss her right out the window, the horses trample her and the dogs eat her, as had been prophesied. And he then, this is Jehu, then has the inhabitants of Samaria. He has them, he goes up to them and says, "You know, you want a piece of me or not?" They said, no, we don't want to mess with you. He says, "All right, well, here's what you do. You kill Ahab's sons and you send their heads to me in Jezreel." And this is what they do. They kill Ahab's 70 sons and they deliver the heads to him and to Jehu in Jezreel. And he then kills other court officials in Ahab's administration because he's charged by God to eliminate Ahab's house. And he does this with zeal. So he does that. And then he even killed 42 of Ahaziah's relatives, the king of Judah. When he's on his way to Samaria to finish off Ahab's house, he runs into some relatives of Ahaziah and he kills 42 of them. So this guy's frothing, you know, in what he's doing. He's just taking people out. So I want you to see what 841, the year of 841 is pretty pivotal, because we have Jehoram, the king of Judah. He dies from this intestinal disease. And that same year, Joram, the king of Israel, and Ahaziah, the king of Judah, they're both killed by Jehu. So in 841, we've got three kings dead. So it's quite a pivotal time. Now, immediately after Jehu kills Ahaziah, who's the king of Judah, well, what happens then? Right after that happens, his mother, Athaliah, well, she takes the throne by force. When her son is killed, she then jumps in and takes the throne. She kills her own grandchildren. Anybody seen my grandchildren knows how crazy that is. But she kills her own grandchildren, okay, to secure the throne, to remove them as a threat to her rule. Now, that's just like her husband had done. You see, you recall, just like Jehoram had done when he killed his six brothers. No doubt under her influence. You see, as we would say, that's how she rolls. See, when she gets in, she's killing people. She takes the threat out, so she kills her own grandchildren. But unbeknownst to her, Ahaziah's infant son, Joash, also known as Jehoash. Sorry, that's just how it is. Okay? Different spellings, different ways. So you have you have Ahaziah's infant son escapes Athaliah's slaughter because Jehosheba, who was Ahaziah's half-sister, she secretly takes Joash from the group of people that Athaliah is planning to kill. So she thinks she's got all of her grandchildren. The threat is completely taken. But somehow in that pool, this infant gets slipped out. So they think they've killed them all, but they're wrong. You see, now you see how close the Davidic line came to being extinguished. That one person, that one baby, was taken by, again, a woman. You seem to see this a lot in the rescue of these children, playing a pivotal role here. But we have Jehosheba secrets him away from that group that was going to be killed. So Athaliah thinks they're all dead, but they're not. And when Joash is 7 years old, Jehoiada, who's the priest, Jehoiada's been raising him and protecting him in the temple. And you can see how dangerous this would be. Nobody could find out about this. Because you see what she did to those who... She killed them all. So this had to be super secret. You couldn't let anybody you didn't trust know about this. You say, why is that? Because that child would be killed. You can take it to the bank, that child would be killed. So Jehoiada keeps this baby and raises this child with whatever help he has from people who could be trusted completely. And when the child is 7 years old, Jehoiada the priest under the protection of armed guards, brings him out into the temple where he'd been hiding for 6 years, and he has Joash proclaimed and anointed king of Judah, and so we now have a rightful ruler, a descendant of David, returned to the throne of Judah. So we had this period, this six-year period, where you had this usurper, this daughter of Ahab and Jezebel reigning in Judah. And so she hears all the commotion about all this, and she comes to the temple to see what's going on. And she comes there, and she sees that now we have Joash named as king. And she yells, "Treason, treason." And they say, "Just drag her out and kill her." And that's what they did. So that's what happens to her. Now, in Israel, Jehu, you remember who'd been anointed king to eliminate Ahab's house? Back in, he reigns from 841 to 814. Well, he attacked Baal worship in Israel. You may remember the scene where he gets all of the prophets of Baal and all these people, worshipers of Baal, and he sucks them in, and they all come, and then he kills them. Well, he attacks Baal worship in Israel, but he continued in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. He continued with the golden calves and worshiping those idols. But because he'd fully carried out God's intention to eliminate the house of Ahab, God promised him that his descendants would sit on the throne until the fourth generation from him. Okay, so he says, so he has a dynasty of his kids and grandkids and great-grandkids on the throne there in Israel. And during his reign, though, during Jehu's reign, the Lord begins to cut off parts of Israel, meaning that there are other nations that come and take parts of Israel. And this involves Hazael, the king of Syria. He took from them the territory east of the Jordan. You remember how Israel, you remember how east of the Jordan, you had the tribes of Manasseh, and you had the 2.5 tribes. We've got territory over there. So what happens here during Jehu's reign, Hazael, the king of Syria, he takes the territory. Ah, there we go. You see over there, that territory, he takes that. You see Syria, also known as Aram. But he takes that territory here. Now back to my kings. If I hit this, is it going to go away again? Or am I doing something wrong? Ah, there we go. Okay, thank you. But we have that. So that territory is taken. Now, interestingly, at least to me, there is this, the black obelisk of Shalmaneser. It commemorates, we went through the archaeology in the Bible. There was this black pillar, and it commemorates, it's known as the black obelisk of Shalmaneser III, and it commemorates the military campaigns during the reign of that Assyrian king. And it says that about a campaign in 841 BC that he besieged Damascus, which was governed by Hazael. He besieged Damascus and he received tribute from Jehu. So we have this Assyrian documentation that he received tribute from Jehu, and there are panels on this thing that depict Israelites carrying various items of tribute, and they show Jehu, or more probably his ambassador, bowing before Shalmaneser. And so I just think there are a number of, in this section particularly, in the Kings, there are a number of, I think, really neat archaeological connections that you just can't take the time when I'm trying to fly through these, but they're really worth looking at. And Lord willing, we'll look at the archaeology stuff again someday. All right, in Israel then, Jehoahaz, who reigns from 814 to 798. Jehu's son, he doesn't depart from the sins of Jeroboam, and the Lord's angry with Israel. So we have now Jehu's son. Remember, he's going to have four that are going to reign. Well, this is his son, Jehoahaz, and the Lord is angry with them because of how they're living there, and they continued to be subject to Syrian domination and harassment throughout his reign. In fact, their army's decimated. They're reduced to just really kind of a small-time player during this king's reign. And at one point, Jehoahaz, he sought the Lord's favor, and the Lord gave Israel relief from the Syrian oppression, it says, by providing a deliverer or savior. It doesn't specify who that is, but it's almost certainly the Assyrian king, Adad-nirari, who reigned from 810 to 783, who subjugated Hazael around 805 BC. So they're getting the hammer from the Syrians. They're praying to God, and he raises up a deliverer, and it looks like it's this Assyrian who comes and blasts Damascus. You see, he comes and blasts them, and he winds up, and that blow gave Israel some relief and some time to rebuild. But they, of course, were paying tribute to Assyria. But it wasn't as bad as what was happening to them under the Syrians. So that's probably what you have there. And then Jehoash / Joash. See, sometimes when they're in Israel, they'll favor the one. And then when they're in Judah, and that's a good way to keep them distinct. But, you know, they're similar names. But we have now this king of Israel, Jehoash, Joash. This is Jehoahaz's son. He walks in the sins of Jeroboam. But he does, you know, despite doing that, he visits Elisha near the end of Elisha's life. He goes and sees the prophet, and Elisha predicted that he would be victorious over Syria three times. This is when he shoots the arrow out the east window. And he goes over and he says, "Then pick it up and strike the ground." And he strikes the ground three times, and he's mad at him. He says, "You're only going to win three times now. If you'd have really beat the ground, you'd have just completely thumped him." But he says, "You're going to be victorious three times just because he struck the ground three times." And three times Jehoash defeated Ben-Hadad, who's the son and the successor of Hazael, king of Syria. He defeats him three times, and he recovers some of the cities of Israel that had been lost to the Syrians. So you see this world always, you know, earlier Philistines, Assyrians, Babylonians. I mean, this was always, you see, times of battle and these kinds of things going on. Well, Jehoash also defeated Judah, the nation of Judah, when Amaziah, king of Judah, insisted on doing battle with him. Now, I'm going to say more about that when we get to Amaziah. But he defeated Judah. And this is when he says, you know, Amaziah is talking big to him and saying, "Hey, you know, I'm going to come take you out." And he says, "Well, there was a thistle down there running its mouth," you know. He gives you that story. So, but that happens. I'll say more about that in a second. Now we get to Judah. 835 to 796, Joash, Jehoash, king of Judah. Okay, and you can see how that could get confusing. You see? But Joash came to the throne of Judah, as I said, at the age of 7. And this is after the 6-year reign of this usurper, this wicked queen Athaliah, who the one who's killed her grandchildren. And under the direction and influence of Jehoiada the priest, you see, Jehoiada is the one who protected him. He's the one who kept him and nurtured him in the temple, kept it secret from everybody, the one who brought him out and had him anointed as king, and the one who was his spiritual mentor. And so he comes out, Jehoiada, and under his influence, you see, the people wind up, they tear down the temple of Baal, they destroy the altars and the idols of Baal, and they killed Matan, the priest of Baal. And Joash also, he commanded that the temple be repaired. And he managed to raise money for the repair of the temple. So everything's looking good with this king. But when Jehoiada dies, okay, that's his spiritual mentor. But when Jehoiada dies, who lived to the age of 130, Joash just goes off the rails. He goes off the rails. You see, the nobles came to him, these people of influence in the society. They came to him and they persuaded him to accept idol worship. Now, you know, this is what people want, you know, people are clamoring, you know, they're going to, and so he listens to them. He had Jehoiada who was giving him the straight scoop. Jehoiada dies and now somebody else has his ear. And you say, well, how can that, what's this, somebody who doesn't have his own convictions well enough? So you can, well, what do you think? Well, no, listen to this. Instead of saying, what are you, crazy? He lets them convince him to go ahead and accept idol worship. And when Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada the priest, the one who had raised him, protected him, brought him to the throne, when Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, rebuked the people by the Spirit of God, prophesied to them, telling them that God had forsaken them, Joash agreed to have Zechariah stoned to death. Now that's gratitude for you. He agrees to have the son of the person who had preserved his life and brought him to the throne and guided him. He says, yeah, go ahead and kill him. So that prophet says as he's dying, May the Lord see and avenge. The words of the prophet. Now, because Judah had forsaken God, the Syrian king, Hazael, he came against Jerusalem. He's coming with relatively few men, but he executed God's judgment against Joash. And you see, God does this a lot of times. He uses people. Can God smoke a city directly? Sure, he can. Why does he do it this way? We'll ask him. But he has his ways of doing things. So he'll raise up somebody and he'll bring them. And so that's what he does here. So we have Hazael comes and executes God's judgment against Joash. They killed the nobles and they wounded Joash before Joash pays him to leave by giving him the treasures of the temple and the palace. You see this a number of times. And you say, well, how many treasures they got? Well, apparently they replenish these things. Because it's a symbol of the nation. So apparently that becomes a big priority. And it seems it goes down. But they want to have something there that speaks of who we are and our royalty and our state and this kind of thing. So apparently they don't let it sit that way long. But you see them paying off. And that's what he does. He pays him off, gives him the treasures of the temple and the palace. And then Joash was assassinated by conspirators. And they refused to bury him in the tomb of the kings, which, by the way, was an honor that had been bestowed on Jehoiada. Jehoiada was buried in the tomb of the kings, but he was not. He's still buried in Jerusalem, but he wasn't buried in the tomb of the kings. Now, when we get to Amaziah, 796 to 767. The dating of the various reigns isn't always clear. I assume you know that. Okay, it takes a great deal of work to try to chart through these things. This chart is from Arnold and Byers, Encountering the Old Testament. And it follows the very influential work and analysis of a scholar named Edwin Thiele. And that it also comports with the dates given in Eugene Merrill's Kingdom of Priests and Walter Kaiser's The History of Israel. So this is one way, and I think it's a solid way of putting things together. But in this analysis, the last 24 years of Amaziah's 29-year reign, it was a co-regency with his son Uzziah / Azariah. Okay, and you say, well, that's hard. Well, let me keep going. You'll see some rationale how that could have come about and how it probably came about. Well, when Amaziah came to power, he killed those who had assassinated his father, Joash. Remember, he's wounded. They go ahead and they assassinate him. He comes to power. He kills those people who had assassinated his father. But he doesn't kill their children. You see, he doesn't kill their children, which most ancient kings would have done. Why? Because they know if I go and kill you and your brother's alive, he's going to be patient and wait and try to kill me. See, so this is what motivates the complete wiping out of family. Because somebody else may mourn your loss, but family may try to avenge it. And so they take them all out. But that's not what he did. He didn't do that. And in fact, he doesn't do it because his view, he says, the sins aren't going to be visited on the children. So he doesn't kill them all. But Amaziah, he brought Edom back into subjection. But he returns then after this victory over Edom, this great victory he has, he returns with their gods. He comes back with their gods and he begins worshiping them. And it's like, you know, and I think this, the prophet rebukes him. It's like, you're going to worship things that didn't protect them from you. You're going to worship their gods? But this is what he does. He's taken by them. But when the prophet rebukes him, he threatened the prophet with death, which is never a good thing. See, when your reaction to the word of God is, I'm going to fight against it. Never a good thing. The only right reaction to the word of God is, you see, thy word is truth. You are God. And so he threatens this prophet. He threatens the prophet with death. And so God determined to destroy him. And this played out in that Amaziah, feeling his oats from having defeated Edom, he picks a fight with Jehoash, the king of Israel. He'd come from Edom. He's feeling, look, you know, who can touch me? I'm big time. I'm powerful. So he picks a fight with the king of Israel. Now Jehoash defeated and captured Amaziah at Beth Shemesh. He brings him to Jerusalem, rips down sections of the wall, plunders the temple and palace, and he takes hostages and he returns to Samaria. Now presumably you see this king, he's in there. Amaziah is among those who are taken to Samaria. It doesn't spell that out, but why would he come there? He captures him, brings him to Jerusalem, lets him look at what he's doing to his city. Then he takes captives to Samaria. So presumably, Amaziah is now out. He's alive. He's still the ruler, but he's away. He's there in Samaria, you see. So this winds up, you know, he's in Samaria. And that may explain, see, why the people, it says the people made his son Uzziah. They made his son king. Why? Because he's now an away king. He's still living, but he's really not doing us a whole lot. We want somebody on site. And so, and because the phrasing is kind of odd, it said the people made him king, which isn't how you would typically phrase a succession. Okay, so you have this idea of the people. So that may be what's at play here. And the statement that Amaziah outlived his captor, Jehoash, by 15 years, that may be an indication that he returned to Jerusalem upon Jehoash's death. So we have him here. We have the king of Judah captive. When the king who captured him dies, he winds up. So we have a stretch of time when he's captive in Samaria. He's there in Samaria, and then he returns, and then his son has already been made co-regent when he's away. He comes back, and you're not booting his son. Okay, so I think that's what's behind this, and I think that makes some sense. Now, in 767, he winds up fleeing to Lachish because people conspired to assassinate him, but they tracked him down there and killed him. All right, so that's what happens to him. Now, Jehu, his great-grandson, Jeroboam II, remember he's going to have four? He's got a dynasty going? Well, his great-grandson, Jeroboam II, he, of course, follows his father, Jehoash, he follows him to the throne, but he walks in the steps of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, meaning he's a bad king. He's doing all these idol worship and the calves and all of that. But that's true of all of the kings of Israel. So you have him there. But God in his mercy, he still used Jeroboam II to restore Israel's boundaries and to really strengthen Israel. To really make Israel more powerful militarily than it had been. And he restores the boundaries, and that had been prophesied by Jonah. In 2 Kings 14:25, that the boundaries would be restored, and this is what happens. And Jeroboam II was the greatest of the northern kings. He was the greatest of the northern kings in terms of bringing Israel to prominence and prosperity. Still unfaithful, you see. All of them are that way. Still walking in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. But he brought them to a prominence and prosperity that wasn't known before. And his death in 753 BC was really the beginning of the end for Israel. They're going to be completely eliminated in 722, 721. He dies in 753. And that was really the beginning of the end. It's not going to be finalized and completely taken out or finished until then. But that begins a downslide. And as Israel and even Judah under Uzziah, both of them times were rolling in the 8th century. But as Israel grew more economically and militarily powerful under the reign of Jeroboam II, moral decay was increasing. You may think, how's that possible? Oh, it's possible. Moral decay was increasing, though they're having more stuff. They're stronger militarily. There's economic prosperity, but they're rotting from the insides. The people became increasingly indifferent to their covenant responsibilities, increasingly indifferent to who cares about poor people? We don't care about them. Just trample them down, abuse them, you see. Do whatever, we don't care about that. And although they clung to these rituals and forms of religion, They engaged in idol worship and they ignored their duties to their fellow man. That was typical. We know that because Amos is sent to Israel during the reign of Jeroboam II, the prophet Amos. And we've studied Amos before. But Amos goes up and just smokes them. He goes up and tells them the score on what's going on with their form of religion and their lack of substance and heart. And how they're, you know, denying their covenant responsibilities and not living their faith. And so he just smokes them there, but they wouldn't repent. They refused to repent. Now, Uzziah, known as Azariah, he's down in Judah. He reigned for 52 years. But it appears, as I said, that he shared the first 24 years of his reign as a co-regent with his father Amaziah. And the last 11 years of his reign, he shares as a co-regent with his son Jotham. So he's got a long co-regency at the beginning and a decent-sized co-regency at the end and a gap in the middle where he's the sole ruler. That's the way it looks, you see. And I talked about, well, what's behind the lengthy co-regency at the beginning where the one guy's taken to Samaria. Now, what's behind the lengthy co-regency at the end is when he's struck with leprosy. You see, he gets struck with leprosy. But he's there, like other Judean kings. He began well in the faith. You see this a number of times, but he didn't finish his life with the same degree of faithfulness. You see this happen a lot. You see, some of them can still be rated good, began well, this kind of thing, but did not finish his life with the same degree of faithfulness. Uzziah had military victories against the Philistines, against the Arabians, against the Ammonites. And Judah prospered under his rule, just like Israel was doing under the rule of Jeroboam II. There were a number of factors going on in the world that contributed to that. But good times are rolling in Israel and in Judah, you see. And so he had numerous building projects, and he also made a lot of machines for war. You see, well, hey, think about, but you see, when you're a nation, this is important. They had technological advancements that gave them an advantage over their enemies, and he was behind a lot of these innovations for war that he had made. Now, the last 11 years or so of his reign, it's shared with Jotham. As I said, that's no doubt because of the leprosy with which the Lord struck him. I hear that bell. When he attempted to offer incense in the temple, that's not for him to do. So when he attempts to offer incense in the temple and the priests gather together and they rebuke him, well, he acts very angrily toward them. You see, he reacts toward this message to him that that's not lawful for you to do it. Who are you? And so he reacts that way, and then he's struck with leprosy. So he's struck with leprosy, and see, the isolation that leprosy required. Because in Jewish law, you couldn't be hanging out with people. So the isolation that required would have made solitary rule impractical. So that's why his son Jotham is a co-regent for the last 11 years. You don't just say he's still alive, but he's kind of out of pocket because he's got to be isolated. So you have the reign up here when his predecessor is in Samaria. Then you have him come back. There's this co-regency that continues, and then you have this co-regency at the end of Jotham. Okay, I think that's how it goes together. Now, Zechariah, back to Israel. His son Zechariah, he's the fifth and final king of the Jehu dynasty. Okay, remember, he's going to have four generations. So this is the last king from that dynasty. He continued to worship the golden calves, and he was assassinated in Ibleam by his successor Shallum. After only 6 months, he comes to the throne. 6 months, he's taken out. Now, Shallum reigns only a month. He reigns a month before he's killed in Samaria by his successor, Menachem. So Menachem comes and kills him, and then he proceeds to the town of Tifsa because they had refused him entry, and he didn't like that. They wouldn't let him come into the town. He didn't like that. So he goes and he sacks the town. And it says that in the process, he ripped open all the pregnant women. Now, see, that little statement is an indication. You see, that's a statement by the inspired writer to tell you this guy's a sick dog. You see, that's why that's there, that little statement. because that was something terrible. Everybody knew it was terrible. The killing of the woman and the killing of the baby inside her was terrible. And so this is something that's an indication of who this person is. Now, Menachem also walked in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and the Assyrian king, Tiglath-Pileser III, he's called Pul, sometimes in Scripture, P-U-L. But he's the Assyrian king, Tiglath-Pileser III. He comes against Israel during Menachem's reign, and Menachem does what? He taxes the people to get enough money to pay the tribute. Because I got to keep this guy happy or he's going to destroy me. And that satisfied Tiglath-Pileser for a while and kept him from destroying the nation. And Tiglath-Pileser wrote about Menachem. This is in Assyrian inscriptions. He wrote, he says, "As for Menachem, I overwhelmed him like a snowstorm, and he fled like a bird alone and bowed at my feet." That's how they always refer to getting tribute from people. You see, that's why you have that thing where there's Jehu, probably his ambassador. Whenever you're, that means I'm dominant. I own you, and so I depict you this way. Now, Pekahiah, he comes to the throne of Israel. Menachem's son, he comes to the throne, walks in the ways of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. He reigns only 2 years before he's assassinated by Pekah. So you got Pekahiah and Pekah. But he winds up getting assassinated. Now, he's variously described in 2 Kings 15:25 as his captain, his officer, his adjutant. You see, but the chronology of Pekah's reign is notoriously difficult. I think Thiele spends a chapter on this. Of how do you put together his reign? It's difficult to reconstruct, and it may well be as many have concluded, and as reflected here, that Pekah, he had such authority in the eastern regions of Israel. You know, those regions east of the Jordan, that he had such authority there. And you say, well, why do you think that, east of the Jordan? Well, you notice when he comes and assassinates, he brings people from Gilead. All right, that's east of the Jordan. So it looks like that's where he is and that's where his power is. So he may have had such authority in the eastern regions that he was something of a rival ruler during Menachem's reign. In other words, they kind of coexist, but he's something of a rival ruler over there. You see, during Menachem's reign, and when he kills Pekahiah, and he assumes the sole reign of the nation from Samaria instead of the eastern region, because he says he rules from Samaria. So he's there in a kind of a co-regency, but there's this rivalry going on. This fella's son comes to the throne, this guy kills him and then reigns exclusively. Okay, and that would explain this statement in here where it says in 2 Kings 15:27 that he reigned 20 years. See, that's probably the key. You have people saying, well, maybe that's a textual issue, you see, but it doesn't look to be a textual issue. And so if he reigned 20 years, it raises a lot of questions of how do you put these things together, and that's the way many people do it. And I think there's something to that. And I heard that bell, and, what can I do? All right. Thanks for coming.